So afternoon, everybody. I'm going to talk to you about some emerging research issues in air pollution science. And air pollution is obviously critical for human well-being and for health. It also affects things like crops. The production of wheat and rice is very affected by pollution. But in this talk, I'm really going to focus on the urban environment. And when we think about the urban environment now in the context of pollution, it's almost always this sort of view of the world that we have, which is associated with cars and with lorries and with buses. And I will talk a lot more about this as I go along. But there is a long-term historical perspective to this. And air pollution, it changes and it morphs over the years. And the first sort of recorded evidence for impacts from pollution go right back to the age of sort of Pliny and Hippocrates, who report air pollution. And it starts off in history being a problem associated with manufacturing, with smelting, with coal combustion, and it begins to morph through the 20th century to be something that was a problem associated with, for example, domestic coal combustion and heating. It changes again in the 70s, for example, in places like Los Angeles, to be a problem associated with gasoline engines. And then as we get into the end of the 20th century and the 21st century, air pollution becomes an issue that becomes defined, particularly around its contributions from diesel and diesel vehicles. So this is where I'm going to bring us up to date, if you like, on where the science is associated with diesel and where we've got and how we've got to where we've got to today. But remember, there's a long history to all of this. So the assessments for the impact of air pollution, they change all the time because the pollutants change all the time. And they're updated, and the statistics are very large. So of the order of tens of thousands of people are believed to die each year prematurely because of air pollution. Through a combination of different pollutants, particulate matter, ozone, nitrogen dioxide. And there's increasing evidence that exposure to air pollution through your childhood impacts on your long-term health. Effectively, it impairs your health for your whole life. It limits the growth of your lungs. It limits your lung capacity. And if you're exposed to high air pollution during your childhood, essentially, though, your lungs will never recover. So you'll be impaired throughout the rest of your life. So it remains a really very significant issue with very, very significant costs. Now, nobody dies and has air pollution on their death certificate. It's a statistical relationship. What it's doing is it's impacting and increasing the numbers of people that are suffering from respiratory illness and from cardiovascular diseases. And it has particular impacts on susceptible groupings. It's the very young, the very old, and those that suffer, for example, with underlying respiratory conditions like asthma. So it has a large cost to the NHS, both in admissions to hospitals and to losses to the economy, measured in the orders of tens of billions of pounds per year in the UK. So to give a historical perspective of where we've got to, this is an assessment made by Wellcome of what everybody died of in the 20th century. So everybody who died in the 20th century somehow appears here. Okay, so this is the entire world's deaths. And air pollution makes up a very substantial fraction of the deaths that are described as being the consequence of humanity. So also under the category of humanity is war and drugs and ideology and various things like that. So to put it in perspective, I've simplified this, but air pollution in the 20th century was believed to have been responsible for about the same number of deaths as all wars or all drugs or about all deaths from lung cancer. So that allows you to sort of get a feel for the size and the importance of the effect. Now, for the 21st century, there's been lots and lots of debate around, will this number be larger in the 21st century when we look backwards, or will it be smaller? This is a long-term historic problem. You would have think we'd have got on top of this. And there are two issues that have got to balance out. The first is demographics. So the first issue that's having a big impact here is that our populations are generally getting older. So we have an increasing number of people in the population that are falling into a category that is susceptible to the impacts of air pollution. And we also have a population globally that is moving into cities, which is where pollution is at its highest. So one side of the equation says that almost certainly this number is going to be higher. We've got older populations and we've got more urban populations. The positive side is that there should be a counterbalance to this, which is that we know a lot about controlling pollution. So we ought to have technology and emissions control, which is pushing the effects downwards. So the big debate in air pollution science is improvements in emissions control and emissions technology counterbalancing our increases in aging population and in urbanisation globally? So I'm going to talk about the counterbalancing, the effectiveness of technology, particularly the effectiveness of technology in reducing pollution from a particular source, which is from diesel engines, which is the one that has made all the news in November last year. And this graph, and it's really the only sort of science graph I've got on here, tells the whole story of what's been going on. On one side, we've got here, this is a graph of the concentration of nitrogen oxides, which are one particular sort of air pollutant, measured in central London over the last 20 years. And despite 20 years of policy to reduce air pollution in city centres, you don't see very much change in that 22-year period, almost none at all. This is clearly a problem. So in that intervening 20 years, people have spent a lot of money buying new cars which had expensive catalytic converters, which had expensive particle traps, which had expensive NOx traps. So we have all paid through policies that were introduced here. So not a lot has happened. So air pollution now is roughly the same as it was in 2000. So we've had almost two decades of static air quality. The other side is what should have happened. This is a measure of the total amount of emissions that are calculated to have been emitted from road transport over roughly the same period. So the big hope was that the introduction of stricter emissions control in the UK, and in fact in Europe and in the US as well, was going to lead to this decline, this dropping, or almost halving in NOx emissions over a 15 to 20 year period. And the problem is it's quite difficult to go from this graph to this graph. This is an estimate of emissions that is built up by adding together all of the individual sources, what's called an inventory. So you go to all of the individual sources and the individual emitters and you say, how much are you emitting this year? You ask them the following year, how much are you emitting? They give you another number. You add them all up, and over time, the assumption was in the UK and the rest of Europe, because the totals kept going down and down and down, that we should be seeing improvements in air quality. In ambient concentrations, nothing was happening. But it's very difficult to make the link between the two. Very difficult to pin the blame on anybody, because there are so many different sources of pollution that contribute to this trend. So we've taken a different approach at York, which is to have a look and see, well, why is the air pollution in places like London not improving? Why is it that the inventories, the estimates of the total amount of emissions, are going down, but in ambient concentrations, things aren't changing? So the first thing that we did is we developed a technology, which I did in combination with a colleague of mine, James Lee, in chemistry, which sits on top of the BT Tower and essentially looks down on a footprint of around 3 or 4 kilometres of central London. What it does is it makes a very fast measurement of nitrogen dioxide. And every time there's an updraft, we measure the turbulence and we see the NOx going up. And every time we get a downdraft from above, we get lower concentrations and the NOx goes down. And we use some mathematics to invert that to get what's called a flux. The flux is the total amount of emissions coming per square metre. And what we discovered was that for central London, the green line is the inventory. That's what governments think is being emitted from central London. So around a peak during the middle of the day of about 100 tonnes per kilometre squared per year. What we measure looking down from the top of the BT Tower is roughly double that, sort of 50% more than that, 150 tonnes of NOx per year. So there's a big problem in central London with more NOx coming out of the surface from the various sources than is accounted for. So this is partly explaining this mismatch we see between the pollution trends and the apparent emissions. Now this is only central London, so maybe something's wrong with just central London. So we extend the technique to see, is this really more widespread? Now to do this is a bit more technically challenging. So this was quite hard, but the more technically challenging is to make the same measurement of the amount of pollutant coming out of the surface, but to do it from an aircraft in flight. Because this way you can cover far more ground. You can look at the emissions over now an entire city. So using a light aircraft, you can see the engines looking out. Oops, I'll go back. Oops, you see who's coming next. Yeah. You look out of the window of the aircraft, and you can see here, this is the sort of flight that we would fly at, about 500 metres, 300, 500 metres above the surface, looking for updrafts and downdrafts. Updrafts contain the pollutants. Downdrafts contain clean air. And as we fly over central London, we draw a map, effectively, of where the emissions are coming from. And now we've got a map that's spread over a far larger space. So you can see the highest emissions take place in central London, perhaps not a big surprise. But what you can see as we fly, and this is latitude, covering roughly the M25 one side to the other, as we get towards inner London, we find that there's a mismatch again between our inventory, that's the sum total of what we think is coming out based on the reported data, versus the blue, which is the measurements. And you can see here far more coming out than has been estimated for. So this, of course, has prompted the really big question about why are these estimated numbers wrong? And, of course, someone who came into the firing line for this, of course, was VW. Now, VW are just one of hundreds of organisations and manufacturers that have to report in data that makes up the inventories. So every vehicle that goes on the road reports in what its air pollution emissions are. Every power station reports them. Every building site, every chemical plant, and so on. So the issue actually is not so much that one company has been underreporting its emissions. In air pollution science, this was pretty well understood that lots of people have been underreporting. VW were just the ones that got caught first. Now, why have we got to this position? Well, one of the reasons we've got to this position is that there has been too much focus on just measuring air pollution concentrations and not enough on checking up on emitters. So there has been an approach across Europe which has been to allow for self-regulation, to essentially allow emitters, including all car manufacturers, to simply report back what they think was coming out of their vehicles. The same goes for almost all pollution sources. Self-regulation has been considered to be the way to go. So this is a question that's been posed by Louise Ellman, the MP, who's the chair of the Transport Select Committee. What did we know about this? Well, the evidence was showing that air pollution wasn't improving in the UK for nearly a decade and a half. So this is a long-standing problem. The issue of under-reported emissions from vehicles is also relatively well understood. It was not a great surprise that a vehicle manufacturer was caught with higher emissions from its car on the road than was under test. The only story, if you like, was VW, was the way they had achieved that reported data. And at its heart is a lack of measurement verification, a lack of independent measurement verification. If we're going to introduce policies and the introduction of diesel engines or the promotion of diesel engines through taxation reductions and so on in the 90s, if we're going to introduce policies like this, we have to have methods that will actually measure whether the policy is having a positive or a negative benefit. And this is a very wide problem in environmental legislation, which is that policies are often introduced with good intentions, and I'm pretty convinced that the push to introduce diesel as a primary source of road transport was well-intentioned, but there was no science and technology to evaluate whether that policy was the right one or not. So we've effectively had nearly two decades of a policy playing out without any measurements and quantification to check how successful that policy had been. If we had been more proactive in measurement, more proactive in assessment, we would have potentially stopped this process sometime earlier. So my final slide is essentially to advertise what I think is the really essential role of universities in air pollution. There is no government laboratory for air pollution science. It was closed down by Margaret Thatcher in 1989. The only people left who are providing independent verification of emissions, that is that they have no skin in the game with a product to sell, are universities. And in the US, it was a university that assessed the emissions from VW vehicles. In the UK, it's York that have made the assessments on the mismatch between London's emissions versus what's supposed to be there. So if you like, we are the only people left standing that are providing a check on what is coming out related to air pollution. So I think there is a really critical role for universities in the future as having no vested interest in the result, but having the skills and the technologies to make these assessments much more robustly than has been done in the past, and to be able to feed back onto policy much more quickly than has been occurring over the last two decades. Okay, so thank you very much.